Good morning, MCCDC. Please take out your worship folder and rise as you're able. We're going to sing a chorus called I Stand in Awe. We've done it before, so I think you're probably familiar with it, but if not, you'll catch on very quickly. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe.
You to remain standing today for our call to worship, which is our statement of faith, and your section will be printed in bold.
Metropolitan Community Churches is one chapter in the story of the church, the body of Christ.
We are people on a journey, learning to live into our spirituality while affirming our bodies, our genders, our sexualities. We don't all believe exactly the same things.
And yet, in the midst of our diversity, we build community grounded in God's radically inclusive love for all people.
We are part of an ongoing conversation on matters of belief and faith, shaped by the scripture and the historic creeds, building on those who have come before us.
Our chapter begins when God says to us, come, taste, and see.
Come, taste, and see. Jesus Christ, you invite all people to your open table.
You make us your people, a beloved community.
You restore the joy of our relationship with God, even in the midst of loneliness, despair, and degradation.
We are each unique, and we all belong.
A priesthood of all believers.
Baptized and filled with your Holy Spirit, you empower us to be your healing presence in a hurting world.
We expect to see your reign on earth as it is in heaven, as we work toward a world where everyone has enough, wars cease, and all creation lives in harmony.
We affirm your charge to all humanity to care for the land, the sea, and the air.
Therefore, we will actively resist systems and structures which are destroying your creation. With all of creation, we worship you, every tribe, every language, every people, every nation.
We know you by many names, triune God, beyond comprehension, revealed to us in Jesus Christ, who invites us to the feast. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. We welcome you indeed to this feast of God's beloved community here in this place. If this is your first time at the Metropolitan Community Church of Washington, D.C., we welcome you, and we remind you that we do not have visitors at MCCDC, but friends who we look forward to getting to know better, and so we are so glad that you're here. We would welcome those who are part of our live stream congregation this morning. And if you're with us on live stream for the first time, we welcome you and invite you to go deeper with our website and when you're in the Washington area to come and worship with us. Again, we are so glad that you are here today. And Reverend Kathy has a word for us as well.
I do. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome to MCCDC. And if you would please open your worship folder, there's a card inside that we call our connection card. If you have a prayer request and would like to be prayed for this week, just fill that out and put your name at the top and put that in the offering plate. And if you are online, if you would go to the prayer tab on our website, mccdc.com, and fill that out, that will go to our church office.
All right, we invite you now to take a moment to silence your cell phones so that we can worship without distraction today. But do check in on Facebook, send out a tweet. Let folks know that this is a place of welcome and a place where we can be together as God's beloved community. And we invite you to rise, introduce yourself to someone you may not know as we continue in worship today.
Please remain standing, take out your hymnal, and turn to page number 4. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, number 4.
Forest, vale, and mountain, flowering meadow, grass.
Continue our worship with a time of community prayer. Our hearts and our lives and our presence and our being drawn together in community. Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, thank you for your love. Thank you for your presence in our hearts. Thank you for being that ever-present God in time of need. Thank you, God, that we can turn to you, our help, our strength, our foundation, that you are unchanging, that you are the God of ages past, present, and future. God, we thank you for your love. We pray this day as community, O God, that you would be with each and every person here, each and every family represented. Give us strength, O God, to do the things that we need to do in you. To love joyfully, to give joyfully, to live peacefully, to abide in your will in the center of our hearts, and to share that spark of love with everyone that you bring into our path. So God, I pray today for those inside these walls and as we leave these walls to our communities, to our homes, I pray for our world, O God, that needs your help, needs your love, needs your people, O God, to be a force for good and a force for peace, so that when wars cease, when hate diminishes, when all of those things that keep us separated from each other are no more, O God, your people can live, your people can love, your people can be that example for you. We pray these things in your many blessed and holy names. Amen.
The experience of prayer, as I have been describing it, can be nurtured and cultivated. It can create a climate in which one's life moves and functions. Indeed, it may become a way of living. It is possible that the time may come when a person carries such an atmosphere of prayer that it impacts everyone and everything. Prayer was the most remarkable impact of the life of Jesus upon those whom he encountered. It was this that stilled the raging of the mad. They called little children to him. They made sinners know that their sins were forgiven. His whole countenance glowed with the glory of the Creator. And the secret, a great while before the day, he withdrew to a solitary place and prayed, as was his custom. Matthew 5:38-48. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the evildoer. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go a mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. You have heard it, that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Creator in heaven. For God makes the sun rise on the righteous and the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your siblings, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Creator is perfect.
If we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing? Then there is a way. If we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing? Then there is a way. We are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing? Then there is a way. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the way.
Jesus is the way. Amen. For the last several weeks, we have been looking at the Sermon on the Mount. One of the most powerful sermons, if not the most powerful sermon ever offered. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is touching heaven. He begins with a call to blessing, redefining what it means to be blessed. He concludes with an invitation to bring heaven on earth in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions. It's a subversive sermon of reversals, reversing what blessing is. And in today's message, In this part of the Sermon on the Mount that we look at, we see Jesus reversing and subverting the very meaning of power. In that time, like in this time, if you ask someone what it meant to be powerful, they might talk about their wealth. They might talk about their position. They might talk about all that they control. In our scripture today, Jesus redefines the very meaning of power. The invitation is to rethink what true power is. The first congregation that heard the message that Jesus taught that day did not have much power, or so they thought. Perhaps when Jesus began to speak that day, the powerless people were hoping for a rally cry. Many of them, in fact, were hoping for a call to arms. They'd heard that perhaps this Jesus was the Messiah, and in their mind, this Messiah is one who would come and shift the power of Rome. As a people who were facing occupation and hating their occupiers, they were hoping for this clarion charge and this clarion call. A rally cry is what they were hoping for, to take back their power. Jesus shocks them. I would love to see the looks on their faces when Jesus said, "If anyone strikes you on the cheek, turn the other also. If anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. If anyone conscripts you for military service and asks you to go 1 mile carrying their gear, go the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." Pray for the Roman oppressors? I would love to see some of the tweets they were sending out that day as Jesus was preaching this message. "You've got to be kidding," I'm sure that many of them were thinking to themselves. The spirit of their time was to strike back, and they were hoping that Jesus would help them in that charge. The spirit of our time is also to strike back. Today we have the tweet wars, we have the political columns, we have various opinions striking back at one another. And yet Jesus in this message is inviting us to rethink what power is, to live differently. Jesus is saying to rethink power, and in rethinking power to also live with higher power. In that call, Jesus says in verse 48, "Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Creator is perfect." This message is a call to what seems impossible. And yet, it is a call to the new vision. What Jesus is offering here is an insight into what God's community can look like as we redefine power in our own lives and subvert and resist the systems that hold power over people. The invitation is to live the new community. Is it possible to live this message of Jesus? Jesus is simply inviting us to live the way that He lived and to create a new community. It takes a person of great power to actually break the cycle of violence. It takes a person of great power to actually not strike back. It doesn't mean becoming a doormat. In fact, it means becoming a person with soul force. This difficult portion of the Sermon on the Mount is among the teachings of Jesus that greatly inspired Gandhi and later inspired Dr. Martin Luther King. And both of them lived the heart of this message in a way that it brought great change. For the people of India, it helped free them from British colonial rule. In the teachings of Dr. King, continues to make a difference in creating a more just world. We have a long ways to go, and the only way we will get there is to continue to live out these powerful teachings of Jesus, to be God's community. In fact, to be perfect as our Creator in heaven is perfect. Now, one of the slogans of this day is, it's not about perfection, it's about progress. Well, it's going to take more than progress to upend our world as it is today into a place of peace. As I looked at what Jesus was talking about here in this call to perfection, indeed, he was talking about perfection. I believe it is difficult to be perfect in thought. However, I do believe it's possible to be perfect in word and action. The thoughts often come raging in to strike back, to be cynical, to lash out. It's possible to recognize those thoughts and then, through intention, to not act on those thoughts. That what comes out of our mouth and what we do with our lives can indeed reflect the very heart of God. This call to perfection is simply to live the character of the God who created us. It is to live our best lives and our best selves. It is to be the new community. Barbara Essex says that God's community is filled with people who think of others first. That is a form of perfection. God's community is filled with people whose every decision and action is carried out for the common good. A community where each person is a neighbor to the other and acts out of love. The capacity of this kind of love is due to the empowering love given by God, who is love. Perfect love. We are able to be gracious, forgiving, hospitable, and generous because that is who God is. And we are the children of God, who showers us with abundant grace, mercy, love, and protection. Those who know God's love can now love their enemies. Those who experience God's forgiveness now can forgive those who persecute them. Those who claim God's gift of generosity can now give back to those who have little or nothing. We are able to do these things because in Jesus we live in the days of God's reign. It's not easy. It is difficult. And yet it is the call of Jesus, and it is possible. The call of Jesus to us today is to be powerful people living different values and different standards. Living with soul force and prayer force and love force. The call to us today is to do nothing less than to break the cycle of violence in word and in action and in policy. The Sermon on the Mount of Jesus is indeed touching heaven. And every day we are called to bring a little bit of heaven on earth. It's to be aware of the thoughts and then to transform those thoughts into words and action that help transform the world. Now, I'm sure that first congregation is asking what this congregation is action. How in the world do we do this? Well, Jesus gives us great insight into how it's possible, and in fact, he concludes the Sermon on the Mount with the way to do it. It is to pray as Jesus prayed. It's living in a way that prayer from the soul and from the heart becomes a way of living. In the contemporary reading today that Pamela so beautifully read by Howard Thurman, we have this insight into how Jesus lived the way he lived. He writes, "It is possible that the time may come when a person carries such an atmosphere of prayer that it impacts everyone and everything." Part of what Thurman is saying here is that Jesus' ability to heal, his ability to call, his ability to transform, his ability to persist was grounded in his soul force, his prayer force. The secret, Thurman writes, A great while before the day, Jesus withdrew to a solitary place and prayed, as was his custom. But Pastor, I don't have enough time for that. Saying we don't have enough time to do that which nourishes and nourishes is like saying a mother doesn't have time to feed her child. We do have time to do the most necessary thing, which is to feed our soul so that we can then feed the souls of others through our lives and through what we bring to the world. To pray and live like Jesus makes it possible to live like Jesus. Jesus was rooted in the Hebrew Scriptures, and surely every day he reflected on the writings from Leviticus. We've recently covered those in the Bible in 90 days. And in Leviticus, we see this call that is woven through, which says, "You shall be holy, for the Lord your God is holy." We've lost so much of the sense of sacred in our world. The sacredness within ourselves and the sacredness within those around us. When we truly see each other as sacred and holy, we cannot see each other as enemies. The call is for inner and outward transformation, to transform ourselves as we transform the world. Jesus is teaching us about God's vision for the world, making time to pray so that we can be, so that we can live, so that we can be perfect and do what seems impossible. Jesus says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. How do we do it? Practice. It takes practice. It's not easy. Hurting people hurt people. And when we hurt, it is not easy to hold back from hurting others. And yet that absolutely is the call. I've struggled with some of these thoughts myself. This idea of being perfect, I mean, I resist that. It rubs against me. How about just working towards an overall, generally positive direction? And yet the call is clear and the call is deep. And we are called to practice and to do what Jesus says. So the invitation at this moment is to actually do it. To practice it right now. This may be uncomfortable, but I believe it will bring the heart of Jesus' teaching into this very room today. Here's the first challenge that I give to you today. I invite you at this moment to think of someone who you might be having a struggle with. Someone, in fact, who you may define perhaps as someone who opposes you, or perhaps even as strong of a language as someone who you maybe would consider an enemy if you were to use that language. Think right now of someone with whom you struggle. It could be a public figure. I'm not making any suggestions, but it could be a public figure. Or it could be someone who has harmed you or others and who you struggle with. Now, for a moment, hold that person before light and before love. And however you pray, I invite you and us together in our own hearts to pray as Jesus invites us to pray. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Let's take time to do that at this moment. Sometimes it seems like your teachings are so difficult. And yet even in this moment, you have called us to pray for those with whom we struggle. We thank you, God, that in a way beyond our own comprehension and understanding, our world has become a little more peaceful right here today, now, in this place. Teach us to pray, O God, like Jesus prayed. You sent your Son into this world to teach us how to live and to save us. So draw us closer to you and to your salvation. Amen. So how did that feel? How did that feel to have that silence in church today and to bring those with whom we struggle into this space? It is hard work, and yet it is the work to which we are called. I do believe that we can break the cycle and we can change our world. The world inside here and the world out there. It's going against our natural instincts, and yet that is the call of Jesus. Barbara Essex continues that there are people who have that capacity to amaze us in how they live. The survivor of a violent crime who is able to forgive the tormentor. Black South Africans who work with their former oppressors to rebuild their country. Those who choose to live modestly so they can contribute to the well-being of the less fortunate. Those who make a choice every day to commit those random acts of kindness. We are surrounded by examples of unselfish love and caring. We only need to look for them. God's world, God's beloved community is active and is moving toward fulfillment. When Jesus offered this message to that first congregation, he was calling them to be a powerful people, to live the very character of God. He was calling them to be transformative, subversive, and amazing, and to live in a way that reflects the character of God. We too are called to be those amazing people who subvert the values of our world. We can do it. Jesus conquered the grave. And when he conquered the grave, he conquered death in all its forms, including the death cycle of revenge and retaliation. We can do it because, as Paul says, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. We cannot do it on our own, but through Christ we can. We can live with this holiness and this perfection, maybe not in thought, but in word and in deed. Break the cycle. Break the cycle of fear. Break the cycle of hopelessness. Break the cycle of poverty and retaliation. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Amen. And so we offer here the deep waters of baptism that invite us to this new way of living and being. We also offer for you here in this place today this oil and laying on of hands, oil of healing and new life. During this time of prayer, we invite you to think about what it means to be a powerful person as Jesus redefines power, to think of practical ways to live this out every day. We'd invite our pastoral care ministers to come and offer support during this time, or simply pray right there where you are. Please rise as you're able for this time of response.
Our hymn of response is number 407, How Firm a Foundation, number 407.
Been made by God in the world.
So we ask that you would center us on that strong foundation, that foundation of your character, O God, that foundation of peace and strength and courage. Help us to be the people you are calling us to be, a powerful people, centered and grounded and living in and through you. We give you praise. We thank you in the name of Jesus. Nombre de Jesus, in the name of all that is holy. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. As we continue our worship, I encourage you to look around. Oh, wait. Go ahead. Look around. Look and see who you see. Saints of God. People deserving of God's love and care. People who have a story to tell. And no one can tell your story but you. As we continue in our time of worship, our time of offering, our time of recognizing our time and our talents and our treasures that we offer to God in this place, I encourage each person to pursue the passions that God has placed on your heart, that only you can fulfill, that God has placed with you. I invite our ushers to come forward to receive God's tithe and our offerings. Gracious God, thank you for your love. Thank you for all your gifts that you've given that we give back just a portion. In your name we pray. Amen.
Our offertory hymn is number 547, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. We're going to sing verses 1, 3, and 5. 1, 3, and 5, number 547.
is thine alone, the trust, O Lord, from thee. Amen.
Please be seated. My beautiful sisters and brothers, Christ our Lord invites to this table all who love and desire to live in peace with one another. So this celebration, as at all metropolitan community churches around the world, is open to each and every one of you. You do not need to be a member of this church or any church to receive these gifts. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks and praise.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and sovereign of the universe. You loved the world so much, you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. He suffered and died for the sin of the world. You raised him from the dead that we too might have new life. Therefore, we join your people from all the ages and the whole company of heaven as we give you this hymn of praise, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Let us pray. O God, send the power of your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this cup, we too might know the very presence of the living Christ. Amen.
Amen.
On the night before he offered himself up for us, Jesus was gathered together with his disciples in a room. They were sharing a meal together, and Jesus took the bread, and he blessed it, giving thanks to God. He broke it, giving it to those present, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. When you gather together, do this and remember me. When the supper had ended, Jesus took the cup. He blessed it, and he gave it to those present, saying, Take, drink. This is the cup of my love, the cup of the new and everlasting covenant, which is poured out for you. When you gather together, do this and remember me. Let us then proclaim what is the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Hallelujah. My siblings, the table is set. These are the gifts of God for you, the most beloved children of God. Please allow the ushers to release you by row and come forward and receive the gifts which are set for you.
Our first communion hymn is number 505, Sweet Hour of Prayer, number 505.
Hour of prayer, whose wings shall mine.
my petition bear. Truthfulness, engage the waiting soul to bless. And since I'm bid to seek God's face, believe just God's grace, I'll cast away my every care and hour of prayer.
And number 506, what a friend we have in Jesus.
Sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often fold this pain we bear. All because we do not carry.
For your love, thank you for your faithfulness. In your names we pray, amen. And now, if you would please rise as you are able and be in the space of
our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed by name.
Adults are having a chili sale as I'm back at 12:30 and participate in their delectable delights. On March 26th, there will be an anti-racism workshop held right here. University will be here. You can find more information in your worship folder. There is a registration for that to go online, so please do so or see me after church. Our crow celebrant. We have a training today at 12:30 in the chapel, so please come on back, and our ministry leader, Dale Basker. On Saturday, as you see in your seat, Rise Up! Musical vignettes of a powerful people. We're inviting everyone to come back and bring. We'll be right here at 5 p.m. on Saturday in this sanctuary. We'll be celebrating Black History Month, as well as bringing you the music of powerful James Brown. Ow, I feel good. Or to talk about the Lenten devotional series.
I'd just like to draw your attention to page 4 in your bulletin. There's our announcement, a rap, a song, a link, a smile, a picture, a paragraph, send an email to Reverend Kathy or myself, and we'll send you the scripture passages that we're being focused on. We're aiming to have the whole thing ready by Ash Wednesday. Mark.
Folder. Thank you.
All right, our closing song is number 474. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Please rise as you're able.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Said, I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
And as you go, what you have, you need. It's in there. So go now and live this call and this faith. In the name of God, our Creator, Jesus Christ.
A rap, a song, a link, a smile, a picture, a paragraph, send an email to Reverend Kathy or myself, and we'll send you the scripture passages that we're being focused on. We're aiming to have the whole thing ready by Ash Wednesday. Mark.
Folder. Thank you.
All right, our closing song is number 474. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Please rise as you're able.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Said, I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
And as you go, what you have, you need. It's in there. So go now and live this call and this faith. In the name of God, our Creator, Jesus Christ. What you have, you need. It's in there. So go now and live this call and this faith. In the name of God, our Creator, Jesus Christ.